Good evening. Welcome to Q&A. I'm Tony Jones, and answering your questions tonight, playwright and performer Lally Katz, the new assistant treasurer, Arthur Sinodinos, former finance minister Penny Wong, who's soldiering through tonight with laryngitis, former Labor Party president, now chair of the Prime Minister's Indigenous Advisory Council, Warren Mundine, and journalist, author, and long-time advocate for Indigenous Australia, Jeff McMullen. Please welcome our panel. Thank you. As usual, we're being simulcast on ABC News 24 and News Radio, and you can join the Twitter conversation with the Quanda hashtag on your screen. And our first question comes from Adrian Falero.
My question is for Arthur Sinodinos, as the former president of the New South Wales Liberal Party. The democratic reform that saw Bill Shorten elected as Labor leader this weekend highlights a stark contrast to the New South Wales Liberal Party, who made news last week for suspending a party member who dared to speak in favour of internal democratic reform. As both Tony Abbott, John Howard, and many other MPs and former MPs are on the record supporting democratic reform in the New South Wales Liberal Party, are these suspensions an abuse of factional powers in New South Wales and an attempt to stifle debate, or are you not allowed to comment on this matter for fear of expulsion yourself?
I don't think that will explain.
Well, look, I don't think I'm in imminent fear of expulsion, and I can comment on the topic. And you're right, Adrian, I was a former president of the Liberal Party in New South Wales. I think what happened in the Liberal Party recently is actually bringing to a head issues that have been going on within the party for a while in New South Wales. A number of the other divisions of the Liberal Party have adopted more grassroots-based pre-selection processes. I'm thinking of places like Queensland and Victoria. And there is a push in New South Wales to do the same thing, and the party president, Chris Downey, is pushing a process to do that, a reform process, of which at one stage I was going to be a part. Now, what does that mean in practice? It means two things. The first is that going to a more open plebiscite system in due course, as you mentioned, there are a number of senior Liberals like John Howard and others who are in favour of that. But we want to do it in a considered way. In Victoria, it took 2 or 3 years of consultation with the membership, with about 10 or 11,000 members, to get a form of plebiscite and pre-selection which was acceptable to the membership as a whole. That will happen in New South Wales in due course. As part of that, what also needs to happen is that we must also make sure that individual branches accept members, that we don't get to a situation where members can pick and where members in a branch can just pick and choose who is part of it. So you don't create factional fiefdoms, so you create a greater openness at the grassroots. Now, the New South Wales system hasn't been a bad system. It's tried to sort of balance control from the centre with control from the grassroots. But it's moving more now in a decentralised way. It will take time, but it will get there. It's unfortunate that there have been some of the incidents you mentioned lately. I'm not going to comment on them specifically,
Can I just jump in, just on that subject? Was it wrong for the party to threaten to expel a reformer who dared to speak out, John Ruddick?
John's status is that he'll be talking to the state executive in a month, so he hasn't actually been expelled yet. But what's been happening over a long period of time is that there have been ructions in the New South Wales division. This has brought it to a head. Actually, in a way, it's good that it's out in the open so that it gets done properly. The other thing that Tony Abbott has done by mentioning or sort of at the first ministry meeting that he wanted to move on lobbyists, we now have a situation where you can either be on the executive or you can be a lobbyist, but you can't be both.
Well, except if you're that party president, Chris Downey, that you talked about, because he is a lobbyist. He's an in-house lobbyist and he's kept his position lobbyist.
Where Tony has gone is that you have to be a registered lobbyist. He's a member of an industry association.
Yes, the Australian Wagering Council, which is, of course, the lobby group for the gaming industry.
I think you'll find that Chris Downey will be one of the people in the vanguard of further reform in New South Wales.
Lally Katz.
Well, to be honest, I don't know many of the specifics or terminology of this, but I guess something that I often wonder about, like with either of the parties, is how you handle when people have all kinds of different opinions and then suddenly everyone sort of has to have the same opinion. And that always kind of boggles my mind because I think I find it sort of hard to believe when people are speaking that that's actually what they believe, probably because sometimes it's not, but I don't know if that's off the subject.
Well, no, in this case, if you had a different opinion, he's been threatened with 5 years suspension. I go back to the question I asked you earlier, was that wrong?
What, to threaten him with suspension? Yeah. I think it was right to ask John to explain certain things which had happened in the past, but the point is that this process will now bring to a head those reform issues that we're talking about. So in that sense, it's good that we can go forward from here.
Let's go to the rest of the panel and hear from this. Jeff McMullen.
Lally is exactly right. It's a mockery of democracy to gag someone who goes on the national broadcaster to try to discuss reforming party behaviour. I mean, that is the problem in both political parties, that you ask your members to keep their opinions to themselves, so you don't really get conscience until you have a conscience vote. You don't really get principle, because it stays in the back room. So until you have the gumption to allow your individual party members and your members of parliament to stand up and say what they really think, then we, the people in this democracy, will go on thinking it's a club. It is not democracy.
Can I just directly answer that, Jeff? Because when I join a political party, the contract I enter into is that I'm joining a particular brand because, in general, I subscribe to the values and beliefs of that particular brand, if I can put it like that. These are movements. For me, and I don't want to speak for Penny, but these are vocations. But you realise when you're part of a team, it's like when you're playing a sport, you do things as part of the team. And I'm not saying you do things against your conscience. If it gets to that point, I'd rather go. But my point is, when you're a member of a team, you have to accept there are rules in being in the team and that you're not always going to win on all issues, and sometimes you've just got to accept the majority verdict and move on, because that will help you to achieve the greater good that you're seeking by subscribing to the values and beliefs of that particular group.
Let's hear from Warren Mundine.
I think it sounds like a zombie apocalypse now. You know, everyone's got to think the same, everyone's got to be the same, everyone's got to operate the same. Now, look, to me, you know, I thought it was quite bizarre. One thing that, Arthur, I do agree with you, did bring it to a head. No one would have heard of John Ruddick. No one would have heard of any of this reform stuff until the five-year ban come out and threatened him. So I'm actually glad that did happen, because now you're going to have a democratic process hopefully put in place and things are going to happen. But I think it is a bizarre situation that a person joins a political party in a Westminster democratic system and then is threatened with banning for 5 years for actually saying what he thinks.
Now, you didn't support the democratic vote for the Labor leadership,
That's
the former
right.
Labor president. I know you're no longer a member of the party, but did you change your mind watching the process?
I found it. There's one thing I did notice about it. I do agree that I wasn't supportive, and I'm still not actually supportive of that process about the parliamentary leader. I think that the parliamentary team needs to pick the leader. I think there needs to be more democracy in regard to pre-selection processes. There's no doubt about that, because I think that's where the real issues are. But one thing that I do agree with, that it did sort of energise the membership, and that's one thing I found quite exciting about it.
Penny Wong, well, you can reflect on the original question and move on to your own situation.
I'm going to first apologise for my voice.
Yes.
To your viewers and to everybody. I thought I'd sound interestingly husky by tonight. Now I sound like a Star Wars character. So I apologise for that. I think a five-year suspension threat is a pretty extraordinary way to deal with dissent. And I get what Martha's saying. I mean, I do think when people vote for a party, they don't vote for Penny Wong. They vote for Penny Wong, Labor candidate. And so, you know, there are certain team requirements that come with that. But I thought that was a pretty odd way of dealing with different views inside the party. We obviously have just gone through a really important and, as Warren says, energising process. And I think it's been great. And it's about trying to open up the party and giving members a greater engagement with the Labor Party. We had two great men campaigning, talking about ideas, engaging with members, and I think it's been a really fantastic process for Labor and one I very strongly support.
Arthur, I'll just come back to you finally on the point. You've watched the Labor Party go through this process. Is there any attraction for the Liberal Party to consider doing the same sort of thing, to actually really opening up the party to democracy?
I think the party is open to democracy. But the point I make about the leadership is, and I agree here with Warren, the best people often to judge the capacities of the leader are the people who directly work with them, who are themselves politicians and know who might attract or not attract support from the public as a whole, as opposed to from the membership of the party. And often there can be a divergence between where the membership of a party stand and the community as a whole. That's been the principle in the Liberal Party. And the other principle has been the organisation raises the money, pre-selects the candidates, and the parliamentary party determines policy and the leader.
And final question.
By the way, if we had a membership-based election at the moment of leader, Tony Abbott would win hands down. Hands down. I don't think that would change any sort of result.
A final quick question, because Tony Abbott, in fact, described this John Riddick as a sort of George Washington character for his honesty and his integrity. That's some years ago. Do you think the party should pull back from this threat to expel him?
John will have the opportunity at the next state executive meeting to discuss all this and I think watch this space.
So there's a lot going on behind the scenes, in other words?
Yes, there is, in other words.
In other words, yes, there is. In other words, what?
Well, in your words, there's a lot going on. We'll see.
All right, you're watching Q&A. Let's move to our next question, which is from Jared Lorch.
Thank you. My question is to the panel. Currently in Australia, we have an inconsistency between the states with laws regarding things such as adoption, age of consent, abortion, even road rules. If we allow the federal government to trump state legislation regarding an issue as popular as same-sex marriage, aren't we opening the floodgates for further forced social policy?
Let's start with Lally Katz. I mean, you came from Canberra originally, I think.
Yeah, we moved to Canberra when I was a kid. I found it a bit surprising because when we lived in Canberra, you were allowed to have fireworks and nowhere else in Australia was. So I don't see why you can't have same-sex marriage in Canberra.
Well, yeah.
Is that a metaphor, presumably?
Maybe.
You are a playwright, yeah. So we can assume that.
It is a metaphor.
Arthur Sinodinos, is this the new government drawing a line in the sand over same-sex marriage legislation?
No. It's a new government saying that there should be national consistency around the definition of marriage and that if we do move in the direction of same-sex marriage, it should be something that's done across the country as opposed to in one jurisdiction or another. I take your point about lack of uniformity across various areas of government and related activity, but this is an area where the Attorney-General is challenging the particular laws in the ACT and the High Court on the basis of creating a nationally consistent system.
Penny Wong.
Well, I don't think we should get too hung up on consistent laws. It took us nearly a century, didn't it, to get the standard rail gauge? So, you know, and there are lots of areas you can look at where you can point to inconsistencies. I don't agree. I think you said forced social policy at the conclusion of your sentence. I don't think it is forced social policy. I think this is an expression of community belief in equality, and I think that many people, and I suspect the majority of the community, do support marriage equality. I suppose, without getting into the big constitutional argument, which I'm sure the coalition will hide behind, my view is, if the federal parliament won't do the job, why should we stop others doing it?
Let's just go back to our questioner. Jared, you had your hand up.
No, it's just that it was brought up that there needs to be the national consistency with the Marriage Act. And I was just, as I said in the question, why is that different to abortion, age of consent, road rules? Why is this the one issue where there needs to be...
Well, in many areas, we are actually striving, as Penny will know from her time as Minister for Deregulation, to get national consistency and harmonisation. And again, it is a bit like the standard rail gauge issue.
Tony, isn't this a great example, though, where the federal parliament lags behind the rest of the country? It's the timidity. We know that two-thirds of Australians do support same-sex marriage. How could anyone in Canberra look at Senator Wong and her partner and deny them the same respect as anyone else who would see themselves as a married partnership? So until we either change the constitution and insert a non-discrimination clause that covers all of these types of cases, the only option is to change the law. So the states, Tasmania, New South Wales and the ACT are clearly leading what is a social consensus, and it is the federal parliament that is way behind the popular will.
Yes, Arthur. I think once again we seem to be arguing by analogy, but I like the idea of do you standard rail, take narrow rail to be your lawfully wedded partner. But no, seriously, you can't make those kind of analogies when it's something that is so important for people's lives, can you?
It's so important for people's lives, I think we should do it on a national basis if we are to do it.
Right, and do you think, incidentally, that it should happen on a national basis? Do you think there should be laws for same-sex marriage on a national basis?
If you're asking me what my view on same-sex marriage is, I've been a traditionalist. I support a free vote, but that would be a debate that we would have in the party room. I don't know whether my colleagues will. But that's where I stand on the subject. It's not a matter of not having respect for Penny. I'm happy to sort of be persuaded. I was brought up a certain way, I admit that. I'm uncomfortable with religious views which seek to paint homosexuality as somehow aberrant or wrong. That is not where I stand on the subject. But I also recognise that sometimes with these issues, you've got to try and take the community with you. So having a national debate is the right way to do that. I don't believe you just force it. I think it is better to have a debate, and I think to have that debate properly, it's also important to give people a free vote if you're asking parliamentarians to stand up on this issue.
OK, Warren Mundine, I suppose there are plenty of other opportunities for the federal government to have nationally consistent laws. I mean, we have the Northern Territory intervention, for example, that's not in other places.
Oh, look, getting back to same-sex marriages, I reckon it is a very emotional subject to many people. And I do believe that the majority of people do want same-sex marriages, but it's one of these things that is so diverse, dividing in the community, so angry that we do need to bring it forward, but we do need to bring it in such a way as that we're not getting too far ahead of the public. So we need to have a National Marriage Act. I'm a great believer in this, and that my personal belief is, you know, going back to your metaphor in regard to crackers and fireworks, I've been married several times and I can agree with that. And my thing is, why should I be the only one who suffers? Why shouldn't Penny suffer too?
Tony, the point you threw out in that question about the Northern Territory intervention, surely, Warren, is the classic case of a federal policy applied to just one part of Australia and to one people within Australia. And the discrimination involved in that is really quite extraordinary. Even the UN has called us on that one. So there is no consistency in our law across the country.
It's a different matter. You're talking about state and territory constitutional issues, and the reality is that states and territories are constitutionally treated differently under the Constitution, of course. I don't know if that's a tautology either. But it's so that's a different issue. Of course, the federal government was able to use its powers in the Northern Territory, which they couldn't do in New South Wales and Queensland because of that constitutional issues. And it was dealing with there's a lot of things about the intervention I don't agree with, but we've got to get back to what the original notion of the intervention was, which was in regard to dealing with some very, very serious issues which were not being dealt with. And this is why I take my hat off to people like Jenny Macklin, who I've got the most enormous respect and pride in regard to the courage she got to stand up for women and to stand up for children.
OK, we're going to just pause that subject because we have a lot of questions on these issues. So we're going to come to our next question, however, which is a video on a very different subject from Martin Connolly in Terrigal, New South Wales.
Why is our government trying so hard to get the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement signed? This isn't a free trade agreement and it affects our sovereignty. Our government can be sued by multinational corporations if they feel they're being slighted by our rules and regulations. For example, tobacco producers. Why are we signing this? What good is it for Australia? Why do we need it?
Arthur Sinodinos, you're the new government. You're dealing with the negotiations.
I'm feeling like the old government already.
Dealing with the negotiations on this Trans-Pacific Partnership.
I think the first point to make to Martin's question is that you enter into international trade agreements when you believe the net benefits, or the benefits exceed the costs. You don't do it in order to reduce your own country's sovereignty. You actually do it to try and increase your prosperity. The issue we've got here, and the reason Martin is asking this question, is because at the moment the negotiations around the agreement are fairly confidential. And the reason being is that negotiators don't like to negotiate in public. But it's been a bipartisan policy that we, as part of being in the APEC group, we try and broaden the free trade pacts in that area into a broader pact, includes the US, ASEAN and other countries. Now, to Martin's point about the issue of sovereignty specifically, he's talking there about these investor-state dispute settlement clauses, which often occur in agreements between developed countries and less developed countries, where you have concerns about the court system or the capacity of investors from a developed country to pursue their rights in a developing country, if you can follow that through. Now, we had indicated in opposition at one stage that we were prepared to consider that in the context of this sort of agreement. But that my view is that given the strength of our court systems and all the rest of it, I'm not sure what benefit there necessarily is in going down that route. But again, when you're doing a negotiation, you have to balance all the potential benefits you get from that agreement against potential costs and see where the balance lies.
But briefly on this subject, when you negotiated the free trade agreement with the United States, that was taken off the table. Yeah. That's those special clauses, yes, which enable foreign companies, yeah, to sue the Australian,
that's right,
government,
that's right,
on the basis of its own laws. They were taken off the table. Why are they back on the table?
There was comment about this from the opposition when we were in opposition. But as I said before...
Well, the comment was, we'll put them on the table.
But as I said before, now we're in government, we're reviewing all of that and we're looking at the overall costs and benefits of going into the agreement.
So perhaps they'll be taken off the table again.
Well, watch this space again.
A lot of spaces we have to watch tonight. Penny Wong.
Well, I think it's a very legitimate issue raised. Investor state provisions, we oppose, in opposition, going back to the Howard government, we opposed its inclusion in the US Free Trade Agreement for the reasons, I think, not dissimilar to the ones, was it Martin, outlined. I do think it's interesting, Arthur, that there seems to be on this area, pardon me, and in a number of others, a difference between what was said before the election and what is being proposed now. I mean, Tony Abbott ran very hard in the election on tightening up restrictions on foreign investment, tightening it up. And we now see that actually that doesn't apply where there is a free trade agreement with China. If he'd gone to the election and said to people, actually, I'm not going to impose any greater restrictions on investment from China, I think people might have understood his policy very differently. I am a supporter of increased trade, as you said, where there is net benefit to Australia, because we are a great trading nation and our economy has grown because we've enabled ourselves to trade, but it has to be under the right circumstances and has to be with the appropriate safeguards.
Is part of the problem here what Arthur just identified, which is the negotiations have to be confidential. In other words, the public doesn't actually get to see what's going on, what's being dealt, what's on the table, what's not on the table. All we know is that in opposition, it was said that these clauses could be back on the table.
Well, it was in opposition what was said.
No, but to Penny's broader point, there are actually a number of cases where we have these in agreements with other countries, including, I think, with Singapore. But my point is this. When you come into government and you are fully in possession of the actual negotiations and seeing what is on the table, then you have a capacity to judge the benefits fully of doing certain things that were mentioned before or not. On foreign investment, the point is this. It is very clear to the Chinese and everybody else what our policy was before the election on that particular subject in relation to the thresholds. And I happen to believe having a strong and vigorous Foreign Investment Review Board actually can improve the public's confidence in foreign investment coming into Australia and actually promotes foreign investment. That may sound like a paradox, but having a transparent process where you actually look at the net benefits of investment coming in, it can actually help to promote the benefits of foreign investment to the public.
Tony, could I just add, though, that in the Asian century, it's not only China that we should be looking at. South Korea wants this particular clause in their trade deal, and they have a billion-dollar threshold in mind. So do we really want to have our sovereignty questioned over an issue like plain packaging for tobacco? Are we going to allow a big tobacco company based in Hong Kong to be able to change our social policy that clearly is a world leader? So some of those delicate issues may be more important than the numbers and the trade involved, because there is no free trade. Free trade is a political slogan. Every nation I've ever been to is really acting out of self-interest, and we've never moved the entire world to a position of mutual acceptance of one another's products. It's always trying to bend things to leverage to get the best for your products. And that's what we're trying to do in China and Japan, get our frozen beef into Japan, or more services and education and special things into China. And they will want more investment in our backyard. There is a balance, but we do have to think of the cohesion and the health of our overall policy before we just sign off on things that are about money only.
I'll just pick up on one point that Jeff McMullen just made there. And that is this whole thing of the international tobacco companies, Big Tobacco, did use one of these clauses in the Hong Kong Free Trade Agreement to try and stop plain packaging laws here, and there is an ongoing court case on that. Is that something that worries you?
We're not going to derogate from the plain packaging laws.
No.
We're not moving on any of that.
I'm just talking about these clauses because they have that implication.
But let's talk granular, let's talk specifics. We're not moving back on plain packaging. That's done. That's a done deal.
Good.
So you'll fight that case?
Well, we are fighting that case. We'll have to.
All right. We've got someone with their hand up down there. I'll just quickly go to this gentleman down the front if we can get a microphone to you. I think we can. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, Sam Silva is my name. Question for Arthur, please. Arthur, could you explain to the audience in relation to the China coalition's approach to, not necessarily applying pressure, but to be fair to everyone in the TPP process, China has pegged their yuan, right? Remember? So no one has... I have never seen people, standing up to that, except for Timothy Geithner, former Treasury Secretary from US, but he was not that sort of very assertive in terms of, in relation to this matter. So what would be your approach?
Talking about the fixed Chinese currency.
That's right, to be fair, and in terms of benefiting for each other, in terms of increasing in terms of trade.
Okay, we've got that point. Go ahead.
I think you'll find that the Chinese leadership are increasingly trying to transition their economy to one based on domestic consumption. And as part of that, they know that over time they've got to liberalise their capital markets, including their exchange rate. Mm-hmm. They're doing it in a gradual way, but they realise that the policies of the past, which involved export-fuelled growth, they have to transition from that. And what we have going on in China now is a very interesting process of lifting the incomes of workers and consumers. And that is good news for us. It's good news for the rest of the world, because that will actually promote the sort of trade that you're talking about, Jeff, because it'll promote their tastes for more processed foods, more advanced services, and for niche innovative manufacturers. It provides us with a great opportunity, and we're going to support them in the process of capital market liberalisation. In my own area, I'm also Minister for Financial Services. We're going to do what we can to promote our capacity to export financial services to the region and to them, including in areas like superannuation and retirement products.
All right, I'm going to move on because we did promise we would get to questions on Indigenous policy. Our next question is on that issue. It comes from Peter Frolick.
Thank you. According to a report released last year from the Productivity Commission, state and federal government spending in total amounted to some $25-odd billion on Indigenous Australia, which amounts to about $44,000 per Indigenous Australian. And to put that into context, that amounts to about double the spend on non-Indigenous Australia. And it seems to me that there's precious little to show in terms of progress on areas like health, literacy, employment, longevity. And I guess the question I'd like to ask is, given that billions have been spent before and billions will be spent in the future, is it time to rethink the way we dispense this money? Or is it time to perhaps rethink whether we reduce the spend in aggregate down to the level of spending and outlay for non-Indigenous Australians?
Warren Mundine,
the broader community.
Well, I think the first part of... Thanks, Peter, for that question. The first part of that is I think we do need a review. We are spending a lot of money for... And I gave a speech in Garma recently and I say where we are improving, we're doing that at a marathon pace, and where we are going backwards, and there are areas we're going backwards, incarceration rate for Indigenous juveniles has just gone through the roof. We're going at a sprint. So we need to have a look at... this election has given us a great opportunity to do a review, to see about where we're spending our money, because my belief is that we don't have to need any more money into this sector. What we need to have is how we spend that money for the outcomes that we need to do, and how we can pick up the pace in regard to the reforms that need to happen. Things like education, things like health, the wide range of things, economic development, because you get economic development and growth within communities, that also helps health and education at it as well. So it's about how we can better spend our money and get the results that we need to do.
Warren, Noel Pearson's argument is that passive welfare has created a culture of dependency among Indigenous people. This has been very influential on Tony Abbott's thinking. What will guide your advice to the government? What principles?
Well, I've said this from day one. Where I'll be looking through, and this is a follow-up again, I just gave praise to Jenny Macklin previously, and I'll give it to her again, is looking through this premise of economic development and looking for how we get commercial activity happening within Aboriginal communities. So when we look at education, and there's educationalists will look in a different way to what I'll look at it. I'll look and say, is it creating the people that we need a job ready? The literacy, numeracy skills, competitive against the rest of the world in this area. Are we going to be turning out the entrepreneurs and business leaders of the future? Are we turning out the people that we need to go into different job areas that we need to have? A good example of that, we had I had a conversation with the previous government about to get the people into corporations and get the people that are going to develop our areas. We needed at least 3,000 accountants today. So we said, that's not going to happen today, so let's start putting in place a program where we get 1,000 accountants over the next 10 years. And then we keep on running programs like that where we're targeting areas that we need to have that work for our communities.
Geoff McMullen, I'll come back to you in a minute, Penny Wong, but Geoff McMullen, your views on, first of all, the question that was asked, but also the response we've heard about the way...
Simon's list of disadvantages reminds us that in a country where just recently the OECD said for the third year in a row we have top of the rank quality of life for most Australians, that in our midst of those 500,000 Indigenous citizens, that we have this extraordinary poverty, the gaps in life expectancy that we're mesmerised by, we have the incarceration rate that Warren's just described that is getting worse, we have teenage Aboriginal suicide that is absolutely tragic, that this is occurring at a time when our nation is celebrating this glorious prosperity. So if we for one moment think we have spent enough or wisely, then we are shamefully turning away from the truth. None of the money directed through a whole era of assimilation government has really focused or empowered Aboriginal people to be able to take the steps towards making the changes that only Aboriginal communities can do. We have to shift trust, investment and confidence to Aboriginal people themselves. Now, that will be Tony Abbott's great change challenge, and I hope it will be the change that he brings to the relationship. A new government has an opportunity. But if we go on spending just as you say, Simon, it won't close those gaps.
That's Peter, actually. That's Peter.
Forgive me. If we do stick with the old approach of throwing money at the chronic illness at the end of an Aboriginal person's life, yes, you're going to pay a lot more money when people are hospitalised with three or four chronic illnesses, but we're not investing in the children. And governments of both political parties have failed to invest in the primary health care, in the early education, in the ending the poverty that people are still living in this rich country. When we do that, then Aboriginal people will come with us as a nation and we will close the gaps. And then we will be able to say this is the healthiest, greatest society on earth.
I'll just quickly come back to Warren Mundine, since you're going to be doing the advising. Just picking up on that point of the empowerment of Aboriginal communities, because so many of them have been disempowered by decades of policy, really. So what is your view on that?
Well, we do. We have to... One of the biggest things we've said, and I sat down with Senator Nigel Scully only in the last week, and we looked at how money's being spent and how it operates in this area, you're looking at probably 30% of that money doesn't even get out the front doors of Canberra, Sydney, Melbourne or Darwin. It doesn't even get to the Aboriginal communities. It's spent Absolutely. In those areas. So for us, it's about how do we get it out? How do we do exactly what you said, Jeff, in regard to getting it down to the grassroots, to the people in those communities, and that's where the money goes and that's where the money is spent. And also specifically target areas that we need to be targeted at. Literacy, numeracy needs to be targeted at us, at Aboriginal people, so that they are able to compete in the job markets, as well as the joy of just reading and writing and doing maths. I know that's a bit of a flip on the math stuff, but it's also about how do we empower people and get them. And I don't like using the word empower, because I reckon Aboriginal people got the power now. We just need to show them that respect, work with them, and so that they got the leadership in this whole area.
All right, let's hear from the rest of our panel. Penny Wong.
Very quickly. I think in this area, probably more than any other area, it is challenging to move from motivation and investment to outcome. And that's been a challenge for successive governments. And, you know, I remember when I was very first elected and I flew into Alice Springs. I was a backbencher. I think we had a Senate committee visit, and I went to one of the camps. And I remember thinking, and I'm from Malaysia, so it really reminded me of some of the poverty near where I grew up. I remember thinking, X hours ago I was in Adelaide Airport and, you know, nice lounge and air conditioning, and this is where I am now, and it's the same country, but it's not. And there's a very good piece that Jenny Macklin wrote today, which I'd recommend to you, which talks about some of what She looked at when she first became minister in 2008 or 2007, her observation in 2008. We've made some progress. The outcomes in terms of early childhood education are better. The outcomes in terms of child mortality are better. The outcomes in terms of year 12 attainment are improving, and we're on track to reach some of the metrics which are so important in the closing the gap policy to ensuring we actually do hold ourselves collectively accountable for outcomes. But there is so much more to do, and there's also so much more for all of us to learn about how we can better improve, work with Aboriginal people, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people to close the gap. But in terms of your question of investing less, I don't think in this nation we should be investing less in a group of Australians who so demonstrably do not have the same rights to education, health and economic outcomes that the rest of us enjoy.
I've got a questioner down the front. We'll get a microphone to you in a moment. Lally Katz.
I guess I would just say that some of the most powerful people that I know are Aboriginals working in the arts, like Wayne Blair, who directed The Sapphires, which has been, you know, such a hit in Australia and internationally. And I just was in New York where Maine Wyatt was, he's an Aboriginal performer. He was starring in Peter Pan on Broadway. So I guess it's about kind of finding things that people can love and that empowers you.
I think you're right. I think the Sapphires and maybe the ABC's Redfern series did more good than probably 20 years of attempted reconciliation, because Australia and the world saw Aboriginal family life for all of the joys that we would agree were always there, but a lot of Australians didn't know it. So that's a tremendous proof of the power within Aboriginal people actually to get the job done.
Arthur Sinodinos, now Tony Abbott is talking about being the Prime Minister for Indigenous Affairs. How do you see things changing?
Well, look, I think the influence of people like Warren, the influence of people like Noel Pearson, and Penny alluded to this as well, the importance of devolving more and more say to local communities, because people out there are angry, and what you've got to do is say, you are empowered, you can take responsibility, you can actually drive the needs, the services that you want. Yes, there are issues around capacity building to do this. There's a bit of an analogy with developing countries. You know, we have aid organisations that go abroad. Part of their job is to promote capacity building in those places. We actually have to do that in our Indigenous communities. But you have to start from the premise that if you give people responsibility, they will respond. If you take responsibility away, that's when you create that cycle of dependence. So it's not about taking benefits away. This is not an exercise in saving money or cutting people's benefits, but it's about the incentives people face. And Indigenous people are like all other people. You'll respond to the incentives you face. And if those are incentives encouraging welfare dependence, you will do that. Now, what is happening, particularly in Indigenous organisations at the grassroots in the territory, in the northern part of Western Australia, parts of Queensland, is they are saying we are going to take the responsibility in our own hands. I've commissioned over the years when I was Chief of Staff to the PM, these various reviews about the money we were spending in Indigenous communities. And you know what came through? There are a lot of people flying in to remote communities, sitting down, having meetings. And that's where, Jeff, some of the money was going. It wasn't actually... And that was all program money. And it wasn't actually going to the grassroots. So I think Tony Abbott is energised by the idea you can make a difference by actually devolving those obligations, those responsibilities to people and giving them the capacity to demand what they want and the resources to do it.
Just to follow up on that, I'll give you an example. I was involved in the 1988 inquiry into the Tumala race riots. And when we went to that community, we found a population of 200 people had 40 programs in that community, and that community was living in poverty. When I come back this year, I did a report for the New South Wales government. We went back and looked at Tumala again. It's still living in poverty, even worse than it was in 1988. And guess what? There are 70 programs in that community. So what it sees is like a cyclone. You see the Aboriginal people in the eye of the storm and sitting there, and this whole storm going around them, money being spent and activities. Because if you ask anyone, everyone's there for good reasons. They're working hard. They're doing good stuff. But it's really not doing anything for the Aboriginal community. We've got to stop that storm. We've got to reassess about how we're doing these things, get the money out in the ground to the Aboriginal people, put them in charge of the process and get them to start working towards it. We can talk about education, we can talk about everything, but until the individual to the group actually sit there and go, as a community, we're going to access the education system and get our kids to school. That's what's got to happen.
OK. I'll pause that question down there. We'll come to you in a moment, but we've actually got a question on what you were just talking about, and it's from Janelle Futcher.
Yes, from Mr Mundine. Do you agree with the concept of self-determination for Aboriginal people, seeing you are a government-appointed member selected to create Indigenous policies which fail to take into account the uniqueness of every Aboriginal community? Also, are you really able to say you can fairly represent Aboriginal people when you support coalition policies that will deny a voice for Aboriginal communities, as we've seen with large cuts to funding for legal aid?
Thank you. I should actually declare an interest in. Janelle used to work for me. She was my PA, but now she's... So this is not a Dorothy Dixon. I'm pretty proud of her. She's off at law school now and studying, so good on you, Janelle. Look... OK, look, What we're attempting to do here is how do we start not thinking of Aboriginal people as one group of people. In fact, they are quite different. In fact, I use the post office hotel approach. When I was a young 18-year-old kid, we used to go to the post office hotel in Redfern, and we was all the black brothers together, and we was all the, Aboriginal people together, until a fight broke out. And then very quickly we broke down, you're a Bunjalung, you're a Wiradjuri, you're a different group and you're a different person. I think it's about time government started recognising that Aboriginal people are not one group. They actually are different. They are different in cultures and different in the way they think and operate from Queensland, New South Wales and other areas. Plus, they're also different from their colonial experience, from the invasion and what's happened to them as well. So it's about time governments acted and started following that. What happens in Redfern is not the same as what's happening at Wilkenya. They're different, need to be treated different. They have a different access to services, and some, in fact, places no services. And it's about that we do recognise on a regional by regional approach that they need to do. In regard my support for coalition policy is that I'll tell you a little story, and I'll be very quick, sorry, Tony, but I'm very quick about this. Tony Abbott has been talking to me for a number of years, and again, I go back to Jenny Macklin, I blame her for this. She got me to negotiate over the Anti-Discrimination Act in the Senate for me, and that's when I met Tony, we had this conversation. The Tony I met those days and the Tony I meet today is a different Tony. This bloke has listened and has learnt and has grown in this thinking, in his way of thinking. I could tell you the bloke I knew in 2008 was a person in regard to Aboriginal affairs, was very conservative, very backward. I'll be quite honest about that. Today, the bloke, when he came and offered me the job to do in February this year, was a different person. He actually sat there and we had arguments about things, we had fights about things. He'd go away, he'd come back 2 weeks later and say, look, I don't agree with everything you said, but let's keep talking about these things. And we kept talking, and he did it with Noel, he did it with a number of other people as well. So he has grown in this space. In fact, he has a, that's why I have the confidence that he's the man for the job.
We have a new Prime Minister, and he has an opportunity to establish that new relationship. And I understand that you have a democratic right. You've worked very hard, and probably the recognition when you were a federal president of the Labor Party shows how hard you worked to get into that space. The difficulty is that every time a prime minister has centralised this issue of policy in the prime minister's department, we see the re-emergence of the chief protector mentality, where Canberra thinks it can actually solve the local problems that you've identified. Now, you've come away from your travels around Australia hearing people say, we don't want more of those chief protectors. You want to shift the trust. Noel Pearson himself argues for getting those regional authorities and getting money into local communities. But to do that, you can't go back to the old patterns, because the Keating government had Indigenous affairs concentrated in there near the Prime Minister's department. In Arthur's day, the Howard government had an advisory committee, and you were on it until you resigned. So an advisory committee that doesn't have the Aboriginal cultural authority, that can't really speak to this diversity that you want to work with, I don't see how that mechanism can do it. How you can shift trust and power will mean diversifying the advice, the cultural voices that you listen to. It may mean opening up to criticism of government approaches.
And will.
But probably something wider, Warren, than I don't know how many people we haven't heard yet, whether it will be five or eight, but if it is that pattern of an advisory committee of hand-picked people who tell a government what they want to hear, probably like you were frustrated in John Howard's day, people will walk away from it saying it hasn't done it. And out around the country, Aboriginal people will say, you haven't really listened. So that's the Prime Minister's challenge and yours. How do you listen, but how do you give that cultural recognition of that extraordinary diversity of opinion and authority around the country?
Well, that's up to that. That's up to those individuals. It's up to those communities. They speak. One of the things we want to make quite clear: Yolngu people speak for Yolngu people. Bundjalung people speak for Bundjalung people. They're the ones. They're the voices of their people. We will not be speaking for them. It's in the. It's our expertise and our operations will be about how do we work for the mechanisms of government. How do we get that funding out of government and working with the public service and the politicians and that back into those communities? That's going to be the massive challenge for us. Look, the enormity of it is, and look, I agree with you, it is an enormous challenge. I remember on the Tuesday I was in Canberra 2 weeks ago and the Prime Minister asked me to sign up. We had conversations for 6 months in regard to how this approach is supposed to be happening and how we're going to do this. And I was very, and I agree that I walked away from the Howard committee because it was a talk fest. It was a waste of time. It was a waste of money. And I don't know why they tried.
So we don't want another talk fest.
No, not want another talk fest.
But how do we empower then the local Aboriginal traditional owners, lands councils?
Well, self-determination was the question that was asked.
That is self-determination.
Is self-determination, are you talking about self-determination but in a different way? I mean, you seem to be talking about self-determination for individual groups.
Well, self-determination, look, it's like the question Mick Gooder said, he raised in his report. He went into a community and this bloke came to us and said, when is government going to give us self-determination? Well, you missed the point if it's about self-determination. You self-determine. For us at the government level, and this, I'm now part of this process, being on this council, is to actually get the monies out, to get the authorities out, to those communities and start recognising those communities to do that. Now, of course, to do that, we're going to have to look at a lot of reviews. It's about us getting on the ground and getting our hands dirty and having conversations. Last week, I was in the juvenile detention centres listening to all those young kids about their stories. And I was also out there in Central Australia looking at the over-governance of those communities and completely stifling that's happening to those
communities. Can I bring Penny Wong in here? Because, I mean, your government kept their Northern Territory intervention going. It extended income management. And I suppose the question is here, listening to this argument, did you do so at the expense of community engagement?
Well, I don't think so. And I know, you know, Jenny and others spend a lot of time engaging with community. And remember, I appreciate people have different views about the intervention. I appreciate that.
But it's run... It's run by vast numbers of bureaucrats who are sent from Canberra to these places. It isn't run from the places themselves, which is the Noel Pearson model. It's different.
Well, I'd make a point. We reinstated the Racial Discrimination Act, so that was a very important change. Yeah. We did also make changes under the Stronger Futures approach, which sought to empower local communities more. And there were, of course, you know, if people want to say you could do this or you could do that better, I'm open to listening to it. But I would make the point that, for example, when we rolled out the housing programs, there was a very strong focus on local employment as part of that, to try and bring not just money coming in via grant, but actually generating skills on the ground. I think that Jenny spent an enormous amount of time working with community to try and design the Stronger Futures policy and Closing the Gap implementation in a way that recognised the desires of those Indigenous communities. Now, okay. I think she would be the first to say, we would all be the first to say, nobody gets all of everything right in every community
across the
country.
But, Penny, it's not self-determination, and that was the question. Are we going to have a government that will allow the legal right? Because, look, a kid born in 2007 in the midst of the intervention that both of your political parties claimed will spend the first 15 years of her life or his life under an occupied territory. That's virtually what it is. It's not the intervention ended.
Jeff,
we've got 15 years. We have 15 years of separate laws and discrimination aimed only at Aboriginal people.
We are not talking about self-determination in the sense of saying we are separate peoples in the one country. We're all in the one country. We owe an immense obligation to Indigenous people because they're the most disadvantaged in our community, but we're all part of the one community. This is a furphy to talk about self-determination. It's better to talk about self-empowerment.
It's part of the Declaration of Indigenous Rights that our government and our nation supports. And if you say self-determination is a furphy, you will never empower the communities that you want to see improve.
Often people technically have used the term self-determination to suggest we are two peoples in the one land.
Can I just interrupt
there? We are all Australian.
Can I just interrupt there to ask the obvious question, Sinodinos? And that is, if you are going to reverse the onus, in other words, put the emphasis back on communities, deciding what happens to communities, rather than some government body or bureaucrat or team of bureaucrats making those decisions on their behalf, disempowering them, how do you do that?
Well, I mentioned before capacity building. We had a program on Four Corners where certain issues were raised. I won't comment on those issues specifically, except to say that that raised the issue of capacity building in Indigenous communities so they can manage their own affairs in a proper way. Because, yes, if you just say to someone at the moment who may not have the training or the skill to manage, whether it's royalties or other money, this is, you've got this and off you go. Well, they're going to be prey to all the whites and others who come in who seek to get their cut of what's going on. So capacity building is an obligation on our part to help people to be empowered properly.
Let's just go back to Janelle, who asked that question. Yeah. Listening to the debate going on, does it answer the central point that you wanted answered?
It was more in terms with the legal funding cuts as well. And with self-determination, how is that possible for Indigenous people when we have the highest rate of incarceration? So cutting something like that, how do we feel self-determined in our communities when we have no access to these, you know, systems?
Yeah, Arthur, that was a good point. I mean, the point was about Aboriginal legal aid being cut. At the same time, you've got this huge incarceration rate. I mean, it's going to get worse if Aboriginal legal aid is cut, isn't it?
Incarceration will get worse if we don't urgently tackle the problems we are talking about at the moment, and if we don't reinforce those approaches. So what Warren is doing, what other people are doing, by bringing those programs under the Prime Minister's department, giving the Prime Minister's imprimatur to getting these issues fixed. In terms
of
cuts,
isn't he? He's just ignoring him.
No, I'm not ignoring the question. I mean, I don't know to what extent there have been cuts
in
Aboriginal.
Well, Hockey said they're cut, and Warren said they're not. That's what she's asking about.
I don't know.
I think
to
that's
what extent...
right. Am I, Janelle?
Janelle, I'm happy to check that particular fact for you. But the point I'm making to you is that we don't want to deal with the symptoms. We want to deal with the causes, and that's why we want to get people empowered so they don't become incarcerated.
OK, we had a question. We had a question down from the floor. I just want to come to that lady, because I did say I would.
Thank you. And all the debate and discussion in the room tonight, and people are clearly passionate about it, but another generation of children will go through primary school and another generation won't go through high school while this debate rages. Frontline workers are the teachers and the nurses and the people on the ground employed by state governments and territory governments. The idea that it can be centralised and the waste of money and the duplication is the large area of concern for these young people. What are you actually going to do to make sure that frontline workers who engage daily with children in schools will work in the schools, will turn up every day and encourage those children to be at school to educate them, instead of having the service delivery that catches them as they fall off the cliff, goes into the jails and educates them? What are you going to do to make sure the education is where the children are as they start in those preschool and early years, the public preschools, the Indigenous preschools, the frontline teachers in classrooms where the children live? That is the solution, and I'm not hearing anyone talking about that.
We did fund more teachers. I think you're right, and I think you'll find that we did fund more teachers, particularly in the Northern Territory. Hence, when I talked about the fact that one of the areas we have actually made progress is in both early childhood, access to early childhood education, and year 12 attainment. I'm not saying there's not more to do, but I would make the point that there was...
All right, we're running pretty close to time. I'm going to go to Warren Mundine. And so the questions raised there really do beg the question about how the extra funding to end disadvantage in schools in particular is going to be found.
Which also answers Janelli's question as well. When we're talking about, on this argument I had with the Treasurer, and you asked about independent things, this is an argument I'm having with the Treasurer in a very public way, and that is that the money should not have been withdrawn in regard to the legal service staff. What we should have did was sat down properly and had a review and looked at the whole legal service approach and how it deals with incarceration rates. And one of the big things of it, and getting back to your thing, is one of the big things that's going to work in our favour about keeping kids out of prisons and out of juvenile detention centres is education. And so it's about how we can look at money being spent in the education areas. Because one of the things I said earlier was about parents having responsibility to the kids, getting their kids to school. Well, that's going to be pretty useless if there's no school and there's no teachers.
But
we need to have that.
So just go back to the point I just asked you. Is that going to work unless there's a huge boost to the money available for education?
I tell you that. Everyone's talking about money. Every person I spoke to in the Northern Territory was... they wanted money. Everyone wanted money. The issue isn't about money. The gentleman at the top there, Peter, raised it earlier and about the amount of money we're spending. It is not about the money. It's about how we better spend our money and better resource this area.
Okay.
Now, that may in some cases mean an increase in some money. In other areas, it may need a decrease in funding.
It does need getting that right. Be brief.
Now, I know what he's going to go on. He just wants money. It's not about money.
No, I want to see all of our children given an equal opportunity for education and health and well-being, and that is the thrust of the question tonight. The truth is, in the Northern Territory, Queensland, those governments are slashing support for teachers. $200 million in cuts forecast in the Northern Territory, where I'm involved, and I see communities that don't have a high school. I see many communities still, despite the previous government's pledge, that don't have decent early learning. So there is extraordinary change underway where Aboriginal people are in control of the education movement and where Indigenous education leaders are bringing the change, but we're not funding education for all of our children. We are cutting the most needy children out of a decent chance for health, education and employment.
OK, we've just got a time for a quick wrap-up from our last two panellists. Lally.
Well, I guess, I mean, I think education probably is the key, and maybe it's about doing... about having consultation with each community about how the education should work so it fits each community and people feel sort of ownership over it.
And Arthur.
One other big change we should make to the question that was raised is we actually talk to the frontline workers more about what needs to be done, and that is part of the challenge of empowerment. The providers of the frontline services as opposed to the bosses in Canberra, Sydney and Melbourne.
Thanks for being brief. That's all we have time for tonight. Please thank our panel, Lally Katz, Arthur Sinodinos, Penny Wong, Warren Mundine and Jeff McMullen. Thank you. Next Monday, the Deputy Nationals Leader and Minister for Agriculture, Barnaby Joyce, Labor frontbencher Tony Burke, comic entertainer Vince Sorrenti, politician turned broadcaster Amanda Vanstone, and military lawyer and hostage negotiator Rabia Sadiq. Until then, good night.